Hey guys, before we get started, so this Friday, it's Black Friday, if you didn't know, so things are going to be cheaper. That includes PROFITFUL, so just saying, you may want to check out PROFITFUL on Black Friday. If you want the beginner's investing course to be cheaper, done. You want Introduction to Stock Analysis, the 8-hour stock analysis course to be cheaper, done. You want cheaper courses around learning about tax on your investments, done. Just saying, if you've been interested in these courses and you want to save some money, then Friday is going to be a good day. Well, I mean, technically the sale goes all weekend, but just put it in your phone. Just go to PROFITFUL if you want on Friday and save money. All right, back to me. Ah, cryptocurrencies, the idea of a cashless currency system where you could simply tap into the internet wherever you are to purchase the things you need. Wait, don't we already have that? But no, Bitcoin is different, and in all honesty, it really is different. The differences are not so much in the outcome, okay? So for most people, you know, using a cryptocurrency system would feel pretty much exactly the same. The differences are all in the system. You see, what happens when you swipe your credit card is information about the intended sale and also information about the cardholder's account immediately gets sent to the merchant's bank. After that, the signal gets passed on and gets chucked through Visa or MasterCard to check for any fraudulent transactions. Then the signal gets all the way over to the customer's bank. Then the customer's bank will put a hold on the funds that are needed for this particular sale. They will then give that transaction a tick. That'll get sent back through Visa or MasterCard, which will get sent back through to the merchant's bank. The merchant's bank will say, yep, all looks good from our end, and they will approve that sale. And what do you know? You walk out with your much desired 12 pack of Woolies donuts. Now, in all honesty, the system there doesn't matter too much. We don't need to focus on, you know, every step of the process. What's interesting to note about that process is that it is reliant on banks, okay, and it's all grounded in a particular currency. It's all grounded in money. You know, if you're in America, it'd be grounded in, the transaction would take place in US dollars. Here in Australia, Australian dollars, you know, Swiss francs if you're over in Switzerland. Now, cryptocurrency is different because it doesn't involve banks and it doesn't involve any form of government controlled currency. That's why they say cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin are decentralized. This means that the distribution and exchange of cryptocurrencies is not regulated by any government. Now, when you make a transaction using a cryptocurrency like Bitcoin, it's actually processed by a large network of computers that are spread all around the world. The encrypted transactions are then verified by the computers in the network, and the transactions are put onto this digitally maintained ledger, continuous ledger, called a blockchain. The computers essentially just cross-check each other and make sure that they've all got the same identical, correct, you know, versions of this ledger, of the blockchain, and that's why cryptocurrencies are so secure. So instead of banks talking to each other and third parties, you know, Visa and MasterCard checking for fraudulent transactions, etc., cryptocurrencies are completely different. They don't rely on any of that whatsoever. It is just a big, you know, network of computers that are continually cross-checking each other and making sure that this blockchain, this digital ledger, is consistently up to date and it's accurate. And when you start diving into the system behind cryptocurrencies, this blockchain kind of technology with the cryptography and whatnot, it's actually very interesting. And I can't say that I completely understand it because a lot of this stuff goes over my head, but it is very interesting. And it does seem like a million times smarter and more efficient than what we currently use. However, there are, at the moment, there is one big flaw with the idea of cryptocurrencies, and that is, of course, that at the moment they're not really being used as currencies. They simply aren't being used by merchants and consumers to pay for goods and services at a large scale. In fact, some estimates say that 30% or less of all transactions of Bitcoin have any economic value whatsoever. So what is it used for? Well, obviously the number one use case for things like Bitcoin or Ethereum or other cryptocurrencies right now is for investing or speculating. It's people that want to buy some of these cryptocurrencies hoping that eventually one day they can sell that cryptocurrency to someone for more than what they paid for it. Now, there are obviously some advantages and some disadvantages through both the cryptocurrency blockchain method that might be the future of currency, and there are also advantages and disadvantages of the standard fiat currency systems that we currently use today. And interestingly, Ray Dalio, the founder of actually the world's largest hedge fund called Bridgewater Associates, a very well-respected investor, he's recently come out on Twitter and had a bit of a yarn about Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies. This is his exact wording in his Twitter thread. He said that, "I might be missing something about Bitcoin, so I'd love to be corrected. My problems with Bitcoin being an effective currency are simple. They are that, one, Bitcoin is not very good as a medium for exchange because you can't buy much with it. I presume that's because it's too volatile for most merchants to use, but correct me if I'm wrong. Two, it's not very good as a storehold of wealth because its volatility is great and has little correlation with prices of what I need to buy. So owning it doesn't protect my buying power. And three, if it becomes successful enough to compete and be threatening enough to currencies that the governments control, the governments will outlaw it and make it too dangerous to use. Also, unlike gold, which is the third highest reserve asset that central banks own, I can't imagine a central bank or big institutional investors, businesses, or multinational companies using it. If I'm wrong about these things, I would love to be corrected. Thank you." Now, I do have to say that I agree with these points entirely. I definitely think that Ray Dalio hits the nail on the head with these three points. So let's break down these points and give a little bit of color behind each one. And the first two points are about the fact that Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies are simply too volatile to be used as a regular everyday currency. He says, one, you know, you can't buy much with it because merchants won't accept it because it's so volatile. And two, it's not a good storehold of wealth because it is so volatile. These points are absolutely bang on. I mean, you can even just have a look at the Bitcoin price over the last few years. 2017, it's gone from 1,300 Australian dollars up to 26 grand, then back down to 4,500, and now back up again to 25 grand. So it's gone 20x, then it's lost 83% of its value, and then it's gone up 5x. This is extreme volatility, and if we were using, you know, Bitcoin or other cryptocurrencies as our normal everyday currency, you would be crapping your pants, right? There's what you want out of a currency is you want it to be nice and stable and not fluctuate wildly, because imagine you wouldn't be able to sleep at night. Imagine going to bed, potentially tomorrow you might wake up and you could be a millionaire, but on the flip side, tomorrow you might wake up and you might have to sell your house just to pay for your groceries, you know? At the end of the day, if you want to have an effective currency, it needs to be somewhat stable. You can even look at the Australian dollar over, say, the past 5 years. It's gone from 73 US cents to 81 US cents, down to 55 US cents, and then back up to 73 US cents. So it's gone up 11%, down 32%, and then up 33%. Now, that's still some decent swinging. Like, that still has an impact. But obviously, it is nowhere near as drastic as what happens with Bitcoin. And for merchants, you know, businesses around, say, Australia that have crunched the numbers and they have figured out the economics of their business operations, it's just simply not viable to use some sort of currency that fluctuates so greatly. Specifically, it doesn't work for them to use a currency that has the potential to have such a rapid negative swing. And, you know, on the flip side, it wouldn't work for consumers either. You know, it wouldn't work if consumers were using a currency, an everyday currency, where there was the potential for it to double or triple or quadruple in a few months or a year. Because in that case, say you needed a new car, you would be desperate not to buy a new car because, quite frankly, you wouldn't want to spend any money whatsoever. You would put as little money back into the system as possible because you'd want to hold on to as many Bitcoins as you had. Imagine if you had some sort of currency that had the potential of going, say, 10x in the next year. people would want to try and hold on to that money, and that would just cause so many complications. Because at the end of the day, you would need to still pay for things, but you wouldn't want to. So that's really my biggest issue with cryptocurrencies, that they're simply too volatile to use every day, just as an everyday currency. So I'm really glad that Ray Dalio touched on that in his first two insights there. At the end of the day, for a currency to be successful, it needs to be a reliable storehold of wealth, and it needs to protect your buying power. And unfortunately, Bitcoin just doesn't do those things. But the third insight that Ray had, which I'm really glad he talked about as well, and this is something that I've thought about cryptocurrencies for years, you know, if it gets too big, if it starts to compete too much with other currencies around the world, governments will ban it. You see, central banks and governments, they like to have control over their currency. And the reason for that is because they like to be able to manipulate the currency so that they can encourage or discourage certain economic behaviors. For example, during the pandemic, what we've seen is we've seen a lot of printing of money, and this has been done to lower, you know, get the interest. This has been done by central banks to lower our interest rates to encourage people to borrow and thus spend money, inject money back into the system, and get the cogs of the economy turning over quicker again after what has been a shutdown. They've also printed a lot of money because they can, because they control, the central banks control that country's currency. They can print more money and give it to the people that have been in desperate need of financial relief because their lives have been so heavily impacted from the lockdown. But obviously, if cryptocurrencies ruled the world, then the governments would not be able to do those sort of things, not be able to manipulate the currency because it's decentralized. You know, the government doesn't have any sort of control over that currency. So overall, I think that if any one cryptocurrency actually started building enough momentum to threaten conventional fiat currencies, I really think just the world's major leaders would probably meet together and say, hey, we like to have control over our currency. We should get together and we should ban all forms of cryptocurrency, in which case it would be quite dangerous for people to actually use a cryptocurrency because obviously it's illegal. You could get found out, you could get fined or whatever, you know. At the end of the day, the government sets the rules. So if you have created something that could potentially poke at the rulemakers or inconvenience the rulemakers, then you're going to have a bad time. So overall, I definitely agree with Ray Dalio, and they are also kind of my thoughts and opinions on why I don't believe cryptocurrencies will become a normal form of currency anytime into the future. Yes, it might happen one day. I think it probably has the potential that something similar, especially the blockchain technology, I think that definitely something like that might happen down the track. But I just see there being too many hurdles for it to jump over. I mean, maybe eventually in the future, you know, it does become more stable and more merchants do start to accept it and more consumers start to use it. And, you know, it does become more of a thing. And I guess at the end of the day, that's what people that are investing in Bitcoin or Ethereum or whatever, that's what they are betting on. They are betting on the fact that one day, they're not sure when it might happen, but one day Bitcoin or whatever they buy will become the next main form of currency and it will be much more widely used. So anyway, guys, they're my thoughts on cryptocurrencies right now. And that's also Ray Dalio's thoughts, kind of my commentary on those thoughts, I suppose. I hope you enjoyed the video. Leave a like on it if you did enjoy it. Of course, it supports the channel, it supports the video. I really appreciate it. And I'd love to hear your thoughts and opinions on cryptocurrencies. Like full disclosure, I'm obviously no expert in cryptocurrencies. As I said, a lot of this stuff flies straight over my head. So maybe if you know much, much more about cryptocurrencies than I do, and maybe you've got some arguments or you can point out some flaws where maybe I don't understand it well enough, then definitely let me know. Like as Ray Dalio says, he'd love to be corrected. I stand the same. I'd love to be corrected if there's something that I'm missing. But from where I see it, I think there are too many factors that mean that cryptocurrencies can't be used as an effective form of everyday currency. And I don't think that'll change for a fair while. But anyway, I'm starting to ramble. Leave a like on the video if you enjoyed, subscribe to the channel, and also make sure you check out PROFITFUL on Black Friday. That is the 27th of November. We're gonna have a sale all weekend long, but make sure you check into PROFITFUL, okay? If you want to learn, if you wanna pick up some of those courses that I've made, if you wanna learn how I go about my investing, the Warren Buffett style, you know, strategy of active investing, if you wanna learn about passive investing, definitely check out PROFITFUL. If you're someone that wants help with your tax, when it comes to your investments, you're just not sure how everything's taxed, how to best structure yourself when it comes to tax time, definitely, if you want to learn about that, we have made some great courses on PROFITFUL. Check them out on Black Friday. You won't be disappointed. All right, that's where I'll leave it, guys. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next video.